what I sing, sing after me. Be my best.
Yeah, echo.
Be my echo if you can be. Sing la la la.
I know he's the one that sang the echo.
Oh, that's the song from Sesame Street.
Me, me, me.
Ha, ha, ha. How many of you remember that song?
I don't.
Okay. Are you ready?
Hello everyone and welcome to Rookie Collectibles. I'm Cheryl.
And I'm Daniel.
And today we'll be talking about First to Market Pops.
So we bought the Powerpuff Girls Pops recently, mm-hmm. And I think you guys have watched that episode already. And we were realizing, you know, because on the stickers on the box, actually, yeah. So I'm going to be flashing the pictures now. Mm-hmm. But the stickers on the box, it actually says 2016 Summer Convention Limited Edition, which we have a lot of pops with that sticker on it.
Mm-hmm.
But at the bottom, it says first to market. So what is that?
Yeah,
we were wondering what the heck's going on. We decided to check it out, mm-hmm. And we found out that, you know, not many people are talking about that.
Mm-hmm.
So we decided to make an episode about it. So hope you guys enjoyed this one.
Mm-hmm.
So let's get into First to Market stickers. Now, we have our usual exclusive stickers, right? That
mm-hmm.
being our Amazon exclusives, our Barnes & Noble exclusives, Target exclusives, everything.
Yep.
There's all an exclusive sticker. And as we know, having an exclusive sticker on the pop makes the pop more valuable in a sense, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, but now, First to Market stickers are something that are just a whole lot, or rather a new world in its own right. Now, because of the fact that First to Market means that you're actually getting the pops, or rather, you know, the product or whatnot, before everyone else does.
Yeah.
And this is supposedly said that Funko releases in limited numbers,
mm-hmm.
First to Market, you know, pops around. I mean, there are sayings that, you know, First to Market pops have been released in numbers of maybe say 5,000, but the funny thing is, you know, when we actually did our check on Prop Price Guide, you know, these Powerpuff Girls pops, some of them, there were more than 5,000 people that own it already.
Yeah.
But then again, I mean, that's just a rough gauge. We would never know for sure if someone might be just playing a fool and saying that I own the pop.
That's true.
Yeah, but speaking of First to Market, let's start talking about previous First to Market pops and basically why is there such a huge hoo-ha around this.
Yeah, so there isn't like a lot of First to Market pops. Probably the very first one that was released First to Market that we are aware of would be the Super Grover. So,
I have Grover!
Yeah,
but it's not Super.
Super Grover.
I just have to show it. Yeah, sorry. I'm very happy there. Sorry.
Yeah, so Super Grover was released First to Market by Toy Tokyo and it was released at the New York Comics Convention in 2014. So this was interesting because we know that Toys Tokyo actually releases their toys, they are a distributor, but they didn't actually have the First to Market.
And the retailer also as well. Like,
yeah, they didn't release it like online or at their physical stores first, they actually released it at the toy convention.
Right.
So I guess there was a lot of excitement, a lot of people clamoring over them, but that, in the same way, there wasn't like a fixed number, they didn't really say how many pieces they released First to Market. So we actually looked at when like the prices of the pops First to Market and the ones that were released after.
And here's the amazing part, right? Both products are the same.
Exactly the
yeah.
same. Not like this one, but the Super Grover one.
my Grover is super too! Yeah, but
super,
I mean, they are exactly the same, aren't they?
Yes, exactly the same.
And even the boxes as well, but mm-hmm. the only thing that was different was
the stickers! Only the sticker was different, but the sticker made like $80, a 10 times different
price.
Yes.
That's mad.
Yeah, so as of today, January 2017, the prices of the First to Market Super Grover was $85, whereas the regular one is just $8.
Exactly.
So it's amazing.
And the regular Super Grover, not this Grover.
Yeah.
This is priceless in my heart. Okay, but anyways, moving on, we also have Neville Longbottom. Now that was released in, let me just pull up the stats here.
Mm-hmm.
Released in 2016, yeah.
Yeah.
So that's kind of new, but mm-hmm. Barnes & Noble actually stuck a sticker on it saying that it's a Barnes & Noble pre-release.
Yeah.
Now that being that, you know, it actually hit stores first and mm-hmm. it is the pre-production model for it. But then again, the interesting thing is, with that, the price on the pop is only $8 in valuation, so it didn't exactly make waves with, you know, and it alternatively it actually could be just that it's Barnes & Noble.
Yeah, maybe. But I guess like the main difference was that I felt why there was so much of a difference in the prices was that Barnes and Nobles only did it as a pre-release and didn't really have like a convention to back up the entire first to market thing. So it wasn't exactly a first to market pop, it was just a pre-release that they released on the site before they actually sold it in the physical store.
Exactly.
Yeah, and I guess like having like a convention where you go down and actually like go and grab the pops makes a difference on how valuable the pops are.
These were the case with the Powerpuff Girls pops as well though. This one was grabbed at San Diego Comic Con if I'm not wrong.
Yeah.
But I think it's interesting though nevertheless, seriously.
Yeah.
Because how you can have such a stark difference in say for example the previous Super Grover pop with Toy Tokyo and then with the Barnes & Noble Neville Long Bottom ones. How many of you guys are holding on to this ones? I'm actually quite interested in finding
out. Actually,
yeah.
How many of you actually went to grab it just because it was supposed to be our first to market and being more valuable as a prediction?
Exactly.
Yeah, so I guess like the discussion of it was that why people were actually unhappy why Funko actually created this entire concept of having a sticker that made these two releases different when actually in
the
actual sense
the
pops are exactly
right?
the same. Yeah, so people are saying like as collectors it doesn't really matter as long as you have the pop which are the same in both release and pre-release.
The one question that I actually want to find out from you guys, especially the viewers watching from the States, is that if you're actually buying the Neville Longbottom pops, do they still come with the pre-release sticker? I'm not sure if that's the case. Does it come with the sticker? Does it not? Let us know. And let us know if you actually bought the one with the sticker or not. So moving on.
So the next one that we have is actually a 2-pack. So this was probably the first 2-pack that came first to market. And there was also a lot of discussion on whether, like, would that mean that the first release would be separate? Like, the first to market one would be a 2-pack and the release afterwards would be two separate pops. So there's a lot of discussion about that, but this was a really popular pop because it was a 500 pieces limited edition one at San Diego
SDCC. That's 2015
Comics
SDCC.
Convention.
Yeah.
Yeah, so there was a lot of discussion and people were back on the topic on whether like if they're releasing it exactly the same way, then was there any value in really going down to chase the sticker of the first to market stickers?
Right.
Yeah, so what happened was that in actual fact, after the first to market pops, the pops that were released to market were actually slightly different from the first to market.
They actually released a metallic version for the 2-pack.
Yeah.
I think it's quite interesting because how the first to market release was a normal version, right?
Yes.
And then the final release that was exclusive to Toys R Us was a metallic version.
Yes.
But personally, what I think was the cause of the price spike in this one was that the normal version is $20 valuation on Pop Price Guide and the first to market versions is $90. That's crazy. That's almost that's like a fourfold of four times, you know, the price. But why I think they actually became so valuable would be that the, you know, it's a limited edition size. So that's the whole reason behind that.
But for me, I guess what I felt Funko did right was that if they're gonna do a first to market and then a release afterward, it's good that they do something that was different.
Exactly.
So it actually made sense for people to go down and get the first to market one and then have something different when it's actually released to the market.
So I think they actually did something right with this one. Personally, let's look at, I mean, the previous two pops that we talked about, they were all the same pops, so what is going on, Funko?
So if there is actually a difference to go and get the first to market one, it makes sense for people to go for that and hence the price increase.
Exactly. Yeah. So I'm thinking, I mean, what was the reason behind that? We are still not so sure, and they are still, however, releasing first market pops, so hey, there will be more to come. I mean, moving on right now.
Yeah.
Let's talk about Unmasked Vader from Star Wars. I really like this one. This is released in 2015 at Star Wars Celebration at Galactic Convention. Really, really like this. I think we might buy one soon.
Yeah.
But the fact that its first to market valuation is $60 means I will be buying the normal version now because
this
is another one.
Same.
Yeah.
Yeah. But okay, this was in 2015.
Right.
The one that was the Superman pops was released in 2016.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I think again the differences. It is stuck because of one single sticker. But
yeah.
That being said, as well, I mean it would be quite cool if you know. You actually headed down to the convention itself. It's quite difficult to get tickets. It's quite difficult to go there. And you actually bought the ones with the exclusive stickers. That is something that could be Funko's way of telling you, hey, good on you. You actually went down. You made the effort, took the trip down and, you know, spent gas money and actually got that pop right there. Jostled with people in the queue for Grovers. And actually got the pop. So I think, hey, maybe that is Funko's way of telling you that, okay, here's a little something.
The interesting thing is that there were actually people who were not at the convention and went and wanted to buy those like pops that were first to market.
Right.
And they actually paid a premium for the sticker and then found out that these stickers were fake. Yeah,
yeah.
So people actually printed like fake stickers to paste on their regular Darth Vader mask.
Oh
and
no,
sold
right, yeah.
Premium. And people are really unhappy, like.
There are a lot of sneaky people on
there
the
are.
Internet.
Please
so,
be
yeah.
careful.
Yeah, yeah, please be careful. Well. Please find out. And I mean, just a top tip before we go on, always ask for pictures.
Mm-hmm.
Always ask for pictures for the different sides of the box as well. And if you're buying a stickered item, ask them for a close-up sticker, mm-hmm. a close-up picture of the sticker for the box. I mean, that's something that I think at least we should all be prepared to take a look at before we actually spend that much money on the pop.
When you're paying for the sticker.
Exactly.
Yeah.
I mean, that's insane though, that's insane. But that is that though, that's what we actually think. Moving on, we're actually interested in really just hoping that Funko would create products, or rather first to market pops being like, you know, stuff that
different.
Actually different from the full production model.
Mm-hmm.
If not, come on, what's the point of us doing that?
Exactly.
Yeah.
But that being said, I guess we're just thinking about like how Funko would do their release in 2017
right.
for the Powerpuff Girls,
yeah.
and it kind of like doesn't really make sense if they were to only release like exclusive
exactly.
Powerpuff Girls
exactly.
following after that.
Because they actually made the normal pops mm-hmm. for this one, so I'm not sure if they're gonna be releasing like a proper full-fledged normal line. Are they gonna do a metallic line? Are they gonna do a gold line? We have no clue what they're gonna do with the pops.
Power up the girls and have like different action poses for the actual
right.
market.
I think that would actually be quite awesome. And then you know that will make all these a little bit more rare and stuff like that. And
correct.
To be honest as well, I mean as a Funko collector, if you had bought a first to market pop and then you kind of realize that they are actually both the same, it is actually quite pissing off because you know I actually spent that money buying a first to market pop and some of them actually costing quite a little bit more expensive
than the regular pop.
Correct. And when the normal one comes out, or rather, you know, actually though, before I continue, this might be a good way to deter flippers.
Yeah, in
right. You know, I'm buying the first market pop. I want to actually sell this like at a later date at a crazy amount. But then, you know, if the normal production, the normal production models come out, and when they sell that, you know, people would actually think that, hey, I'm just gonna buy the normal one. I'm not gonna buy that first market one.
Yeah, it could be a move on Funko to avoid that. But
so
I think it would be cooler still to release a slightly different.
Exactly. So Funko, if you're watching this, please, change your lines a bit. Yeah, keep things a little bit more exciting so that we can speculate. We can keep excited for them as
but
well.
But I guess one thing would be that if they were to only release like exclusive versions of the Powerpuff Girls after that, I'm guessing the mass market would be a bit upset because Powerpuff Girls is such a popular animation series. And if you were to like deter your regular people from buying like the regular Powerpuff Girls, that would be quite sad as well.
Okay, but let's now round up this video. What's your final take on first to market pops? Will you continue buying them if you do see them, or will you not do that?
I guess I would buy them if I really like the series anyway, because to me collecting like toys after all is buying something that you like.
Exactly.
Yeah, but it makes me a bit sad that knowing that there's so much speculation behind first to market just because of the sticker.
Right.
Yeah, so I do hope that they release something slightly different, if not expand the line and I don't know, have action figures, action poses. And
awesome,
yeah.
I mean, ultimately for me, I think all in all, it is still a pop nevertheless. It's still something
that's
that, we're all still collecting for the fun of it.
Yeah.
I mean, unless the prices are exorbitant on the get-go, I think why not, right? If we do love it, just like Cheryl said, just go grab it. I think, I mean, if you're buying with the intention of flipping, then please be careful. I mean, you know, you might, it's kind of like a risk.
Yeah, it is.
So it depends on what kind of risk you're taking. I guess so, But I know for sure I'll be keeping my Powerpuff Girls set and my Grover. Alright, thank you guys for watching this episode of Rookie Collectibles. We hope you like this one. We kind of rented on for a little bit. Let us know if you like us to talk more about stuff like that, do more reviews.
Love to hear from you as well what you think about first-to-market pops.
Exactly. Do you have first-to-market pops? You know, let us know. Let us know your experiences as well. Drop them in the comments below. And as always, smash that like button.
Hit the subscribe button.
Of course, don't forget that. And thank you guys for watching. We'll see you guys in the next video. Goodbye!
Sing what I sing, sing after me. Be my echo if you can be. Sing tra-la-la.
Oh, now tra-la-la.
Me, me, me.
Me, me, me.